Church, that was hearty. Praise the Lord, church. Amen. You know, I was on my way back and I was praying about how to open, and something came to me, and it was, God is here. And so I looked to see what scripture that might be. So I looked up a scripture and Googled, God is here, in the Bible, right? There's really no scripture that says, God is here. It's because all I found was, God is with you. God goes with you. So God is here, not because he's established himself here and he's placed himself here, and every time we come here, he is here. But because he is with you, where two are gathered in his name. Now, there's a thing, though. There's a clause there, in his name. You can come here and where two or three are gathered, and if you come here and look for his name, you're not in his name. If you come here and expect things to happen because God is here, because he's with two or three of us, that's a good thing. I think God can use that if you search after that. But if you come just because it feels good with the two or three, you know, the Bible talks a lot about those people, the ones that went with the multitudes but weren't a part of the disciples. It's kind of a sad place to be. You know, if you come from the back of the line just to see who God is and how he moves, then you'll want to be a part of it. But you got to get to that place, amen? This is your fault, Rachel. You said it. I'm not here to preach. I'm here to open. All I'm saying is, God is here. God is here. No, you're not hearing me. God is here. God is here. We're his people, amen? Where God is, there's healing. There's faith. There's things that happen, amen? So sometimes I think as people of God, we can get caught up in life, right? We get caught up in the situations that occur. We get caught up in the raise from work. We get caught up in the trials and the things that, the stresses of our job. But God is here to take the burden so that you could see his face clearly and not be clouded by the stuff that goes around us. Amen? That's why we come here, just to get rid of some stuff. To cast our cares on God, amen, that we can see him work in our lives and everything that we do, amen. So let us stand in this place, and let us expect God to do something, amen. Let this not be a routine service. Routine service would be, we come, we feel it, we go. Let's not have this service be this way. We are his people, amen? He goes with us, amen? Hallelujah. So if that's the case, let's just have him have his way. So let's pray to him right now. Lord Jesus, I pray, God, that you would have Lord, I pray against any pride that might be within me, that might be within anyone in this place, God, that you would bind that pride up, oh Lord, and loose your humbleness, Lord. Humbleness that we would pray for you, God. Pray that you would be here with us, Lord. Hallelujah, because your word tells me that if we would humble ourselves and pray, hallelujah, and seek your face, then you would heal our land. So I pray, God, that you would heal our land. I pray that you would heal our church. You would heal our people. Oh, mighty God, that we would see you move in a mighty way. Oh, Lord, let glory be to you. All of this is for you. So we praise your name, Jesus, for what you're doing. Let us praise him now, church. Hallelujah. We have put our trust in you.
Hallelujah. 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 Glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. There's freedom to dance. Hallelujah. In His presence, there's freedom. Hallelujah. There's liberty. Thank you, Jesus. God, we worship you, Lord. Hallelujah.
Glorify the name above all names.
you, Lord.
We want you.
And we need you.
We want you.
We need you.
We want you.
We need you.
We live to glorify your name.
I think we need to sing it again. Somebody needs to glorify him a little bit more.
Sunday school kids this morning, there are a lot of songs out there that make you feel a lot of different ways. The song that comes to my mind is that, in the arms of the angel, and they show the dogs in the commercial. That makes me feel a certain type of way. It makes me feel sad. But I'm telling you, those songs make you certain, but this is different. When you call in the name of Jesus, that something supernatural happens in the place. It's not no Sarah McLachlan, that's the name of Jesus. That name has power. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. It's so good to be in the house of the Lord on a Sunday night. I'm going to take the offering now, so if the ushers could come. And I was reading this verse earlier. We've all heard it in regards to giving. Malachi 3:10, bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be meat in mine house, and prove me now herewith, saith the Lord of hosts, if I will not open up you the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing that there shall not be enough room to receive it. And I was reading this, and I never realized, beginning there, it says, bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse. All God's asking there for is the tithes. And he's going to pour out this blessing that we can't contain. The thing that already belongs to him. He said, if you just take that step of giving that back to where it belongs, I'm going to give you a blessing that you can't even contain. So what would happen if we dig a little deeper than just the tithe? I'm wondering, I think this building is here. We're in this place because we dug a little deeper than just the tithe. We dug a little deeper, and I just think God can do something miraculous. Let me go a little deeper than just the tithe. Amen? Amen. So last Sunday, Eve and I, we took an offering for McKenna Crystal's mission trip. And the Lord just put a number on my mind. It wasn't a big number, but it was a number. So I said, okay, I can do that. So I did it. And the very next day, my dad gets the mail. He brings me an envelope, and there's a check in it for three times what I gave that night. I mean, I wasn't expecting it. I didn't know where it came from. I'm just telling you, God is faithful in the little and the big things. Has anyone found that to be true in their own life? Amen. Hallelujah. So let's pray over this offering. Let's just pray that God will bless it and bless the rest of the service. In Jesus' name. God, we worship you, God. We thank you for the sweet presence we feel in this place, Lord. We thank you for all you've done for us, God, for the blessings you poured out, Jesus. Oh, for your faithfulness, God, for your love, Jesus. And we just pray you bless this offering, God. You bless those who cheerfully give unto you, God. And you just be true to your word, Lord, like we know you will. In the name of Jesus, and the church said, amen.
I can't Song without smiling, something's wrong. Come on, I'm looking for a smile tonight. Amen. God is good. It feels good in the house of the Lord. I'm eager to hear from our pastor tonight, and I would ask you to help me welcome him in Jesus' name. Would you find in your heart to clap your hands and welcome our pastor in Jesus' name? Amen.
Oh, I get joy when I think about what he's done for me.
Oh, I get joy when I think about what he's done for me.
Oh, I get joy when I think about
what he's done for me.
Oh, when I think of what he's done for me.
Now, you know, we come to church. If you've been in church all your life, you don't even think some of the songs you sing sometimes. You just sing songs, you don't even have a clue. You know it, but you just, you know, it's sort of like driving. Have you ever got all the way home and realized, man, I don't remember driving home? Yeah, it's like, whoa, that's a scary thing right there. You didn't even think about it. And I think we do church like that sometimes. We just come have church, we don't think about it. But that song tells us, you know what? You got to think about what he's done. I don't know all the verses, but he says he healed my body and he told me to run on. He saved my soul, told me to go on. I'm just here to tell you, when you think about the goodness of the Lord, Brother Graham, you're right. You got to put a smile on your face. You got to say, thank you, Jesus. You got to say, praise the Lord. Oh, you don't know like I know
what he's done for me.
Oh, you don't know like I know.
Done for.
house. Oh, would you give him a shout of praise in this house? I'm going to praise you tonight, Lord. I'm going to glorify you tonight, Lord. I'm going to magnify you tonight. Oh, come on, somebody give the Lord a shout of praise. Yes, 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 yes. Praise God. A child of God needs to be the happiest person in the world. I don't care what happened on the job, what happened at home. My God, he's done a work in my life, and to his name be glory. Would you say amen to that? Come on, would you give the Lord a hand clap one more time for what he's done? Oh, bless the Lord, oh, my soul, and all that is within me, bless. Oh, I'm going to bless his holy name. Come on, reach way down inside of you and pull it out again. Like that. Man, I'm just here to tell you, there ain't nothing that lifts my spirits any quicker than just getting in the car and shutting the door and start singing all by my lonely. Man, you can raise your hands. People won't think you're goofy anymore. It's just a great thing, and thank you. And I, let me just simply say, you know what, I would to God that we would step into a new level of worship that we've never been in before. And maybe I'll touch on that a little bit tonight, but man, you know, Saginaw, I remember before my dad died, most of you don't know, but I love to have fun, and I love to play tricks on people and jokes on people, and my dad told me one day, son, you're going to have to grow up someday. And that was a long time ago. That was 25, 30 years ago, and I'm trying. I really am. But you know what, Saginaw Valley, they say the church goes many times like the pastor goes, and that's a little scary thing right there. But you know, we need to grow up. We need to become a deeper. We need to become, you know, I tell people around here that have gray hair, I love gray hair in this church, because when I first moved here, there's all of us, most of us here didn't have gray hair. Believe it or not, Daryl didn't have any gray hair, and George didn't have gray hair, and Dave didn't have gray hair, and I didn't have gray hair, and some people had hair, but you know what? There's another songwriter says, the longer I serve him, the sweeter he grows. You just find out that God's greater and richer, and we just need to grow in him like never before. Would you say amen? If you have your Bibles, would you turn with me to the book of Matthew chapter 7? Thank you, praise team. You guys did great today and tonight. I remember the days that it was just one guy standing up there with a songbook and doing it. And sometimes that can be fun too. But man, there's something about when people get up and start magnifying him. Nothing greater than that. That's leading people into worship. Leading people into worship. It's leading people into worship. It's to lead somebody, you have to do it yourself. And so to every dad in this house, we need to learn to lead our family in prayer and lead our family in worship and lead our family. And we have to step out and do it. We got to be the example of what we want our kids to be. Matthew chapter 7, thank you for being here tonight. Thank you, Brother Graham, for a great word of the Lord today in response. Praise God. This week and this month, this year, I've been talking about a journey. And I'm going to come back to that. But tonight, I don't necessarily want to focus so much maybe on the journey of our individual, but we as a church taking a journey and to be what God has called us to be. In Matthew chapter 7, verse 13, enter ye in at the straight gate. Wide is the gate, broad is the way that leadeth unto destructions, and many be there that go in there at. Because straight is the gate, and narrow is the way that leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it. When I was a boy, one of my favorite preachers is Paul Mooney. And I heard Paul Mooney, I don't know what scripture he used or whatever, and I didn't have a title for this until I sat up here tonight. But I remember Paul Mooney preached a message at our camp called, "It's Not for Everybody, But It Is for Somebody." So if I want to put a title on what I'm going to talk about, it's not for everybody. That narrow gate's not for everybody, but it is for somebody. And everyone's not going to be going that way. Everyone's not going to be walking this way. Everyone that says they're a Christian is not going to be going there. Let me take it a step far. Everyone that comes to Saginaw Valley may not be going in that narrow path. Man, we'll be down and dirty here tonight. Maybe, you know, you better pray for pastor. But I'm just telling you what the Word of God says. There's two paths. And each one of us get to choose which one we're going to go down. Lord Jesus, I love you. And I thank you for your presence. I thank you for this family. I thank you for this church. I thank you for every believer, every friend that's gathered in this house today. I pray now, Lord, that you'll speak to us, Lord. If you don't show up, nothing's going to happen. But if your presence can be in this house, something supernatural can happen. In the name of the Lord Jesus, we'll thank you for what you're going to do. In the name of the Lord. And everyone said amen. 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 God bless you. You may be seated. As a boy, I was in the station wagon with my family, my parents, and Keith, the oldest, was still with us. And I don't remember a lot of times being in the car with Keith. Had a station wagon, so you had the front seat and you had the next seat. And then there was that third seat that you could have facing forward, or you could flip it back and it could go, it could be backwards. And I don't think they make those anymore. Now they call them Suburbans or Venture Vans or whatever. And I remember we were on our way to Ashland, Wisconsin, and we stopped at a roadside park, and I was following my brother Neil, who was following my brother Keith. And as we walked down to go to the lake, we're walking down this pathway, and Keith kicked a hornet's nest, not knowing. And I seen him turn and run. Now, I have never seen it before. I've never seen it since, that somebody running can kick off their shoes and kick off their socks nearly at the same time. And Keith was an amazing, I see that sometimes play back through my mind. And Neil was nearly doing the same. Thank God for little Kevy, who was the third guy in the bunch, who turned around fast enough, and I wasn't stung that night, but they were walking down a pathway. Pathways are always interesting, especially when you're not knowing where they're going. If you have no clue where you're going, a pathway can be a destructive thing. But when God gives you and I the ability to walk down a pathway, it may be narrow. It may not be a real heavily pathed path, but you can be of assurance it's leading unto life. It's leading unto the things of God. It's leading unto holiness and righteousness and godly living. And ultimately, it's leading to a place called heaven. So there's two different pathways that we can take. The narrow one, the wide one. The narrow one, not many on it. It's not a real broad path. It's pretty narrow. But there's another path that a lot of people are walking. It's just not the alcoholic. It's just not the drug addict. It's just not the perverted guy. It's, if you're not careful, all of us can be walking down this pathway that's not leading to heaven, but it's leading to destruction. And it behooves you and I to realize that we must be very careful and cautious to the fact what pathway I'm on. In fact, I believe you walk down a pathway every day. When you get up in the morning, you're going to determine what pathway you're going to walk down. You're going to determine how you're going to get there. You're going to determine how it's going to, because simply you and I will walk a pathway every day of our life. I will go so far to say Saginaw Valley United Pentecostal Church is walking down a pathway. It almost has its own personality. It is. It's just who we are. And we are, as a group, a body of believers, walking down a pathway. And if we're not careful, we'll find ourselves a long ways from where we thought we were going. I know an old elder in a church that I used to attend, that church found themselves going down a wrong pathway. The problem was, is they didn't realize they were going down a wrong pathway. In fact, the problem was, is it was become I don't want to get into it, but years later, after a new pastor came in and said, all right, here we go, and they started setting up the old landmarks, did the church realize that how far they had drifted from that pathway that church had once been established on? And the old elder said, I never realized how far we have drifted from the pathway until the signs were put back up. It's vitally important that you and I realize that we are, every one of us, walking a pathway. We and the body of Christ, this local church, is walking. And we need to realize the pathway. We need to have an understanding of it. In fact, the writer of Romans gives a warning to Romans church in Romans chapter 13 and verse 11. And he tells us that we need to know the time that we're living in. We need to have an awareness of where we are in this world today. We need to have an awareness of what time it really is. And today is daylight savings, the first day. And I always love it when the clocks change. I just wish they would do one thing. I wish they would make the time change on Monday instead of Sunday. It sure would help the attendance on Sunday morning. Now, it probably wouldn't help at the workplace because everyone would be sleeping in, or they lost that sleep that hour, and so they're sort of fussing about it. But I love that we can have that time change where things, and we can realize that things are a little, I'll turn my blinkers on up here. Excuse me, you got to shut them off. I'm not going nowhere. But it's important that we know the time, the Bible says. And in fact, he says so much of this. He says in Romans chapter 13, it's high time to wake out of sleep. It's high time to wake out of sleep. Do you know there's some of you are hard people to wake up? Now listen, I used to be pretty bad. In fact, I was so bad that when I got a job at 19 years old and had to set an alarm, I had to put the alarm underneath the bed. Because when the alarm would go off, I would put it a part of my dreaming. And I would let it go, dee, 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 dee. I'd just sleep on. But if I heard it, then I'd have to get up and I'd have to cry. I used to reach over, just slap it and go back to sleep. Now, I know there's some of you in here that have done that. You just slap that thing. I wanted to do that this morning, too. I wanted to slap that thing and go right back to sleep. And the danger is if you slap it and it goes off, that it's a hard thing to wake up. Sometimes in the morning I wake up, and I told Sandy the other day, I remember my father-in-law, I remember going in to help him get up, and he would sit on the bed, Sean, and just stare. Not say a word. You'd walk in 15 minutes later, he's just sitting there staring. And I found myself this week sitting on the edge of the bed, just staring. It must be an old thing, I guess. Maybe you don't realize, but you'll wake up someday and sit on the edge of the bed and just stare. That's all you'll do. It's like, and it's a hard thing to wake up sometimes. Have you ever woke up in the middle of the night and, man, you're ready to go? But it's still 3 hours you get to sleep, so you go back to bed for 3 hours, and when the alarm goes off, it's like you just stare. I don't understand that, but the word of the Lord tells us that we as the body of Christ need to wake up, and we need to understand that it's high time to wake out of sleep. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, it's time to wake up. Turn to your other neighbor and say, neighbor, it's time to wake up. It's time to wake up, Saginaw Valley. It's time for us to wake out of sleep, because the problem is our salvation is nearer now than when we first believed. That's why we need to wake up. We need to wake up to the way that we used to walk with God. When we first came to God, man, we had fire, we had enthusiasm, we had everything going for us. But as time goes on, we sort of wane from that a little bit, and we get a little sleepy a little bit, and what used to move us no longer moves us. The songs that used to put us on our feet worshiping God no longer puts us on our feet worshiping God. The preached word of God used to have so much force. The reading of the word had value to it, but no longer, because we have been lured to sleep. We have found ourselves. And the word of the Lord saying, you got to wake up, because your salvation is nearer than when you first believed. Come on, would somebody clap their hand unto the Lord? He says, the night is far spent. The day is at hand. Let us cast off every work of darkness. And listen, I'm not here to tell you what those works of darkness is, but the Holy Ghost will. And if you're having some trouble wondering if it's the Holy Ghost, maybe you can come ask me. But I'm here to tell you, it is the plan of God, and it is the will of God, and it is the purpose of God to do a work in your life that causes you to cast some things away. There must be something, there must be some cleaning, this spring cleaning, this must be getting this thing out of us. And I'm here to tell you, the word of the Lord tells us the night is far spent, the day is at hand. And I'm here to tell you, I think those words of those scriptures have value for you and I, and has value for this church, and that we need to cast some things off, the works of darkness, and let us put on the armor of light. Now listen, I could take some time and explain all that, but I think maybe we understand that the Holy Ghost will lead you this week. The Holy Ghost will guide you this week, and something will click in your spirit, and it will tell you that's darkness. Now, if you got the same Holy Ghost I got, that's what it is. Did anyone else in this house have that experience? Maybe you're reading something. Something says, that's darkness. Well, you got two paths to walk. You can go on the broad path, or you can take the narrow path. You and I, you can watch something, and something will tell you, that's darkness right there. The problem is, now that's getting pretty deep right here. I remember my daddy preaching that verse of scripture, and I didn't like that scripture at all, because he didn't just say it's seared with a hard iron. I told you a couple weeks ago, they cut that nerve in my leg, and I'm sorry. You know, I was thinking, man, I repeat a lot of stuff in my life. Kyle was making fun of me the other day at a restaurant and telling me about the things I repeat more than once, and so, but you know, that nerve was cut. My main nerve, my leg, I don't know if you ever heard that before, but that main nerve was cut. It would have been a totally different story if it had been seared with a hot iron. Because if it had been seared with a hot iron, it would never been able to have been put back together. So the day that you and I find our conscience being seared, is a day that you will probably never come to a place of repentance again. Man, I wasn't planning on going down this path, but let me tell you, there's that verse of scripture that haunts everybody. That there's a place that you can come that you can't find a place of repentance. And the only thing I can understand that can be is because you're never willing to ask God for forgiveness. I stood as a little boy listening to a man, I could name him today. I stood in that aisle and I listened to him tell my father, I can't repent. And my dad says, you can repent. And he says, I can't repent because he'll never forgive me. And he walked out and he's still lost today. When the opportunity was, if he would just repented. But I think there was a hot iron somewhere was seared. I think something happened right there. Listen, I'm telling here tonight, I'm a long ways from my nose, but I'm in the Holy Ghost right now. Don't allow that spirit that speaks to you to sear that voice in you. Because you will come to a day that it won't speak to you anymore. And man, if you find yourself and that voice is not speaking like it used to speak, you need to find a place to pray. You need to come back to an altar and realize it's the last day. It's the last hour. I need to wake out of sleep because my salvation is much nearer right now than it was way back then. Don't allow that to happen. Don't allow the night is far spent, the day is at hand. Let us cast aside every work of darkness and let us put on the armor of light. The word of God, read the word of God, pray the word of God, seek the face of God, worship, do all those things that we you know, the church and the word tells you to do. Put on the word of light. Put on that word. Walk out the door tomorrow morning saying, I'm walking in faith today. I'm walking in the faith that God has put into my life. And the devil's a liar and the Lord's victorious. And I'm going to whip hell today. I'm going out in the name of the Lord today. I'm going not in my might, but I'm going in the might and the light that's in the word of God. No weapon formed against you can prosper when you're walking in the light. Hell may come against you with everything it has, but greater is he that's in you when you're walking in the light. I'm here to tell you, no devil can hinder you when you're walking in the light. Put on the light. Put on the light. Because we belong to the day, and we must realize we're living in a deception day. We're living in a day that deception's on every hand. Perversion is at every corner. Drunkenness and immoral living and strife and anger and all those things that this world is so infested in must not be infested in Saginaw Valley and must not be infested in us as the members of this church. We can't have the things of this world infesting our life. We can't afford to have it because the light of God is not going to be in our life. We got to cast that junk off. And when the Holy Ghost speaks to us, we got to realize, I got to get rid of this. I got to get rid of that. Have you ever gone through a real house cleaning? Brother Fleetwood, they loved antique furniture. And there was Brother Brian and myself, and I can't remember who all went down. Brother Morno, we went down to their house down in Indiana to move them up here. And they had all kinds of antiques, and they had a sale. And, man, hundreds of people came, and they were selling all that stuff. And he told me, he says, when I moved to Saginaw, he says, they bought that property. It's no longer, the building's no longer there, but that rib shack place up on is where the church started. There used to be a theater there. And when they went in, it was filled with old furniture. And he says, we cleaned it all out and threw it out at the street. And he says, we stood in that second story window and looked and watched a traffic jam as people were scrambling to get the stuff we were throwing away. And he says, we laughed at him. Said how foolish them guys are to take all that stuff that we just threw out. And he says, now I look back after it and I think, what a fool I was. He says that threw all that stuff away. He had a house cleaning. There needs to be a house cleaning in our life. We need to allow the Spirit of God to move in. Then he says this in Romans chapter 13. But put ye on the Lord Jesus Christ, and make not provisions for the flesh to fulfill the lust thereof. I'm telling you, that verse of scripture haunts me. That verse of scripture is in my ear. And put on the Lord Jesus Christ. Provision. Those are things that you just set aside. You don't need them right now, but you're going to need them. These are things that you're not going to be involved in, but you'll set it. This is wrong, but I'm going to set it over here. Just keep my hand on it. Just if that magazine in the house, I know where it's at. I know the book that's there. I know what it's all about. I know the video that's there. I know the YouTube channel that's there. I know that. And you make provision for it. Sometimes you may need to get rid of it. Sometimes we need to get rid of YouTube, and we need to get rid of friend chat or whatever that was, all those things are. And we just need to get rid of those things. Why? Because is it sin? No, it's, but it sure is a weight. And the word of the Lord says that we need to lay aside every sin and the weight that is so easily beset us. So we need to put on the Lord Jesus Christ, not making provision to the flesh thereof for the fulfillment of the lust thereof. Instead of walking in the path of this world, why don't we choose to walk in the pathway of God? He goes on to tell us that we need to put on something. He says we need to be put on. We need to be clothed ourselves with the Lord Jesus Christ. We need to walk in the presence of Almighty God. Have you ever been around people that you know walk with God? And have you ever been around people that simply walk with people that walk with God? Because they're two different people. There's some people that just walk with people that walk with God. But there's other people that when you're around them, there's a peace and there's a contentment and there's a joy and there's victory and all that stuff. Why is it? Because they're just not walking with people that walk with God. They're walking with God. And the vital importance of that is, listen, when you do that, you clothe yourself with the Lord Jesus Christ. You make no provisions for the flesh, not allowing yourself to go down that old pathway and determining in your mind, I am going to live for God. Listen, no one else can do it but you. No one else can make up these decisions but you. You can go to all the self-help classes you want, but until you make up your mind, I'm going to walk down this pathway, you can hear it all day long. There's enough Thayers around here. But there was a guy named Bob Thayer that I think all these Thayers had something to do with. But Bob Thayer used to say, I can't even remember now, how's it go? You can buy all the books and send them to school. But, oh man, I can't remember. It was sort of a catchy little thing there. You can eat all the covers off or whatever. If you're not going to learn it, it's the same measure. You can build libraries, but if you don't help people to read and teach them to read, there's no need to have in the libraries. It's a reason that you and I need to close ourselves. I can do a whole lot better when I buy something if I have the manual to how to put it together. Sandy and I are looking at buying this desk. And when I look at it, it just haunts me. How many times have you bought something and you decided you didn't need the manual and you put it together? When Brandon was a little boy, Sandy decided he needed a school desk. And so it was made out of this plastic stuff. And Sandy put it together, but she put it together backwards. So the desk wouldn't open like it should. It fell in. I mean, it was a disaster. And once you put those little plastic pieces together, you're all done. How many times have I tried to put something together and then I go, well, give me that stupid manual. I always say there's a little Chinese guy somewhere over in China laughing because some dumb American's trying to put this thing together, you know. But if you have a manual, you can put it together. So I want to talk to this church tonight for a few minutes about a manual that we need to have as a church, as a body of believers. We need, God, if you would simply give us a manual. Manual, we could do a whole lot better in doing some things around here, because it's just not our ideas and our thoughts and how we think we can do things. I believe God has given us a manual. In fact, I was thinking this afternoon, Israel found themselves in a backslidden condition, and all of a sudden someone was having a spring house cleaning at the temple, and they pulled out the word of God, and they said, "Well, marvel, look at this. Wow, this is the word of God." And so the next day they called for a holy assembly. And the Bible says they stood all day long and just listened to the reading of the word of God. Something had so clicked in their spirit, they said, there must be something to that book right there. I'm afraid that sometimes we fail to realize that the word of God is a manual for our life. And you know what's so incredible now is the family Bible used to be that book, big book. I don't know if you have a big family Bible sitting on the living room table or not, the dining room table, the coffee table. They used to have those big family Bibles. Does anyone still have one of those on the coffee table? You do. There you go. You're spiritual people. I don't know. I don't need one on the coffee table because I got one right here. Isn't it amazing? The Word of God goes everywhere with us now. It used to be, well, I just don't have time. Well, it's just, you know, it's hard to read. Well, you don't even have to learn to read the Word of God. You just scroll on down there and hit Bible, and man, it'll just read it to you all day long. And it's just, it's amazing. And it's the Word of God. And it's the Word of God that needs to be in our hearts and our lives and needs to be in this church. We need to find that the Word of God, and I don't know who in the world is texting me right now, but I will shoot them. Sandy says, don't say that. I just... I get people in this church while I'm preaching, they start texting me. I could have fun with that right now, but I won't. But I'm just... I want to start. He was one. But they started out as a very holiness people, very strong in the word and very dynamic in their preaching. And this evangelist, his name was Gibson Smith. And he would go around. I'm sorry, it was Gypsy Smith. I knew that wasn't right. But Gypsy Smith, I don't know if you ever heard of him or not, but he was just a great evangelist that evangelized in Europe, and he even came to North America and had great moves of God. And one day they asked him, someone asked him, he says, how is it that you can walk into a city and have revival? How is it that when you're done preaching, the bars are shutting down? How is it that your ministry can make such a change in a city that when you walk out of the town for the last day, you have ultimately changed the destination of that city? And he sat down and he talked to them and he said, there's two factors. And he says, the first one is the first thing I do is when I get to a city, I try to find the highest place in the city. And there I go and I pray. I pray and I seek the face of God. That God, if you don't show up, nothing's going to happen here. And without your help, God, no one's going to come to know you. So, Lord, I ask you, I plead with you, I beg you, would you bring revival to this ungodly city? And I would to God that that would be the number one thing in our life that we would do as a child of God, is would be a church that knows how to pray. And because we learn how to pray, it's coming from the Word of God. The Word of God is that manual that can instruct us. And the Word of the Lord is what will lead us and guide us. And when you turn to the New Testament, you have Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Then you come to this book that we talk a whole lot about this book, but I don't know how much we always practice this book. It's called the Book of Acts. It's the Acts of the Apostles. And so just to give you, I have more notes than I can preach here today, so I will just give you the first three chapters of the book of Acts. But when you open the word of the Lord and you begin to read the book of Acts chapter 1, you'll find out that the disciples of Jesus came and asked him a question. Lord, when are you going to restore your kingdom upon this earth? The question is, Lord, after you've come back from the grave, after you've come victorious, the only question we have, Lord, is can you give us the time that you're going to set Israel free and you're going to restore our kingdom? They were not looking for an outward thing. They were looking for something that would just benefit them. And Jesus had something to say to those Jewish men, those ones that had followed him for 3.5 years. Jesus said, it's not for you to know. Have you ever been told that? Have you ever thought, man, I'm really getting here, and all of a sudden said, well, you just don't need to know. It's not, you don't need to know. Man, it can deflate you right away. I'm talking to the Lord. When are we going to restore this kingdom, and when is everything going to cut? And the Lord says, it's not for you to know. But he said, I will tell you this. He says, you shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. Well, I'm talking about building a kingdom here. I'm talking about restoring something here. And Jesus said, I'm here to tell you, you're going to receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. And I want to also let you know that you're going to be witnesses unto me in Jerusalem and in Judea and Samaria and to the othermost parts of the earth. Jesus wasn't looking for their idea of what he needed. Jesus was saying, I want to let you know what's fixing to happen here. You're going to receive the power of the Holy Ghost. And when that Holy Ghost comes upon you, you're going to start building a kingdom, not for yourself, not for this world, but you're going to start building a kingdom for a world to come. I've come to tell Saginaw Valley today, we don't need to be trying to build our own kingdom. We don't need to be trying to say, how can we establish a kingdom here? But what we desperately need to have, we need to receive the power of the Holy Ghost. I'm here to tell everyone that sits in this room today, the most important thing that you need in your life is the baptism of the Holy Ghost. It doesn't matter if you have any money in the bank. It doesn't matter if you live on the good side of town. It doesn't matter what kind of car you drive. What matter, are you filled with the power of the Holy Ghost? Are you filled with that supernatural power that comes from the throne of God? Saginaw Valley, we need, I don't care what this building is, more than a building, we need the power of the Holy Ghost resident in this church. It needs to be from the kindergarten class to the nursery class to the adult class. It needs to be from the pulpit to the back doors. It needs to be in every classroom. We desperately need the power of the Holy Ghost resident in this house, resident in this church, resident in our classes on Wednesday, on Sunday night. God, give us that Holy Ghost power. Come on, would somebody clap your hands unto the Lord? It was a promise that they would receive it. It was a promise that was given to every man, woman, boy, and girl. That means it's for you and it's for me. The question is do we have that power? Or are we running on our own ability? Are we running on just what we think it's going to take? Are we running on some kind of program that we think, well, this is going to work? The problem is, if you don't have the power of the Holy Ghost, we're no better than the YMCA. And thank God for the YMCA. Thank God for places that try to help people. But listen, I want to let you know, we're not the YMCA. We're not some country club. We're not some Saginaw club. What we are is the church of the living God that needs to have that power to become witnesses to this whole world. And can somebody say amen? So my question is, do you have that power? And if you don't, why not? So it was a promise in Acts chapter 2. The promise came. You find out from the very beginning, when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. They were of one mind. Saginaw Valley United Pentecostal Church, we got to have one mind. We not only need to have a oneness in our message, we need to have a oneness in our unity. We need to have a oneness. This church is not just any kind of church. It's a Holy Ghost filled church. It's a holiness church. It's a given church. There's a oneness about us. You wonder who we are? We're Saginaw Valley United. We have one purpose. We have one goal. And that's the same goal that Jesus gave the disciples. You're going to receive power that comes upon you, and you're going to be witnesses. Listen, if you want to know if you have the power, it's a matter of, are you a witness? Because if you're not a witness, you don't have the power. Ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. And it doesn't say ye may be a witness. You shall be a witness. And he tells us how far that witness is going to go. It's going to go from our backyard. It's going to go from Jerusalem. It's going to go to all Judea. It's going to go to Samaria. And it's going to go to the uttermost parts of the earth. Listen, Saginaw Valley. Thank you, Alex. I think it was Alex last week gave that missions thing. Dan or one of them talking about going and reaching the lost. But let me tell you, I'm all for that. And I think this church understands that. But listen, we need to be more than just reaching to Africa. We need to be more than just reaching somewhere around the world. We need to be reaching in our own backyard. We need to be reaching our people, the families of this church. We just need to be a church that's witnesses of the power and the might, that there's a oneness about us. Saginaw Valley United Pentecostal Church, we must have one purpose, and that is to be filled with the power of the Holy Ghost. And can someone say amen? Something happens in a believer's life when that comes. Something supernatural happens in every believer when we become drunk on the things of God, when we become drunken in the things. And Peter and the rest of the apostles, they stood up and they weren't afraid to proclaim. Listen, you want to know if you have the power? You're not going to be afraid to proclaim. Because Peter and the rest of the apostles, they stood up that day when the doors started filling up, when people said, these guys are drunk. And they had no problem standing. It wasn't just Pete. You read it. It's Peter and the disciples. They all stood up with one accord and said, these men are not drunk as you suppose, seeing it is the third hour of the day. But this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. They already had the ammunition. They didn't have to go pray about it. They didn't have to go get a Bible study somewhere. They already had the goods on board. Listen, if you got the power, you need to have the words. If you got the power, you need to have a witness. You need to be able. Listen, you got your own personal testimony. You got a testimony that I'll never have. You'll have a way how God brought you out in a miraculous way that I can't even compare to. But I got my own too. So don't you come busting me either, because I got me a testimony that God can keep me and he can sustain me, and I don't have to go out and do all that stuff and go all that place to talk about the redemption power of God. I got a testimony, and if I got the power, I can't help but tell you what God's done for me. So I'm looking for a pattern here. I said, God, would you help me find a pattern? I had missed it. And all of a sudden, he took me back to Acts and he said, it's right here, boy. It's right here all the time. And you're going to receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you. If you are a timid individual, I'm here to tell you, you can have a boldness in the Holy Ghost like nothing else. One of the greatest lady speaker in this movement tonight is 93 years old, I believe, and her name's Vesta Mangan. And Vesta Mangan will tell you when she was in her 20s, she was the most timid, she was the most shy, she couldn't stand in front of people. Well, you look at Vesta Mangan today, and you would never believe that she would have been that type of woman. She's preaching better now than she's ever preached. She's preaching with an anointing greater now than she's ever preached. She just preached to 4,000 preachers the other day, and my God, she turned the place upside down. She's 84 years old. What happened? She has some power, and it's not some self-help book somewhere. She has an anointing on her life. I'm here to tell you, you may be timid and you may be shy, but when you get the power of Almighty God in your life, you will be a witness. You will proclaim. You will tell the world about how great God is in your life, how he brought you out of darkness into this marvelous light. He put my feet on a straight street. He gave me strength and might. Let me tell you about my Jesus and what he's done for me. So I'm here to tell you, there's no excuse for not being a witness. Is that making sense? There's no excuse for that. And you need to find easy ways how to do things like that. One of the best ways I have found in a restaurant, when the waitress or anyone, I was talking, I always say this, where you go to church? And if they do this to me, if they go, I said, gotcha, pal. You haven't been to church in a long time, have you? All right, tell me where grandma went. Where did your mom and dad go? Where did you go? Oh, you haven't gone. What? Have you ever had any church? And you know, it's amazing what happens. Even when I put them on the spot, where you go to church? And you know, it just gives me a break into it. I was going down to Tupelo, Mississippi the other day. We stopped by and went to dinner with the Netherys and the Dobbs. And we went to this little place. And man, it wasn't a real fancy place. But man, did they have some good food, buddy. And we're sitting there and we got ready to leave. And the waiter, he was a great guy. And I said, where do you go to church, pal? And he did that. I nipped it in the bud right there, buddy. I pounded on it. I said, you need to go to these guys' church. You're talking about a church. Now, I don't know. It's a Pentecostal church. They say it's a good church. So it's going to be a good church. It better be a good church. If I ever go back there, the guy shoots me because and I'm just telling you, do you understand what I'm talking about? There's no need for you and I not to be a witness. Because there was a boldness that became upon them that they begin to preach the word. I'm here to tell you, when you're filled with the Holy Ghost and that boldness comes upon you, it's amazing how good you are. Now, just a show of hand, I'm going to get real spiritual here. We're going to get somewhere with these hula hoops in a minute. You may think, Pastor, what are these hula hoops doing here? Have anyone in this house have ever testified to someone about the goodness of God and you walked away thinking, wow, where did that come from out of me? Yeah, it's been there. You walked away, woo, man, I'm a Jeff Arnold right there, buddy. I'm a Anthony Mangan. I'm just some bad dude. And if somebody would ask you beforehand, you'd have stumbled and fallen all over. Well, I don't know. You need to talk to my pastor. I don't know exactly. You know what? When you're filled with the Holy Ghost, I'm here to tell you, something comes upon you. There's an anointing that begins to flow in your mind. You need to practice. I think everyone needs to practice their testimony. And I think everyone needs to study the Word of God. But I'm here to tell you, in fact, God says this. He says, I'll put the words in your mouth. Now, that's pretty cool right there. That's pretty cool right there when you just start talking and you're thinking, where are these words coming from? And it gives you a holy boldness that standing in IGA, standing at Myers, you can say, hey, can I pray for you right now? Can I hit the throne of God for you right now? Listen, I'm going to be praying for you. I had a man call me the other day out of blue. He goes, hey, this is Joe. Who's this? And I said, well, I don't know. Who's this? And he said, this is Joe. And I said, hi, Joe. And he goes, why did you call me? I said, Joe who? He said, Joe so-and-so. I said, I don't know Joe so-and-so. And immediately I thought, it's no accident. No accident here. But I said, hey, Joe, where do you go? And bang, hung up on me. I thought, I missed it. I'm just here. You need to be looking for those times. And when God begins, I challenge you tonight to be an apostolic church. I'm challenging you to go tell your story, just what happened in the book of Acts. Preach the word. Listen, I'm not asking you to be preached. I'm just telling you to tell your story of the goodness of God. And when Peter got done preaching that day, 3,000 souls were added to the church. That's a story. So what's your story? That's the book of Acts chapter 1, the book of Acts chapter 2, the book of Acts chapter 3. Now it gets good. Now they've had their Pentecost. Man, I got to finish here. But they've had their Pentecost and they received the power. And now the Bible says in Acts chapter 3, Peter and John were on their way up to the temple at the hour of the afternoon. And as they went, it was right at the gate, beautiful, the gate leading into the temple, where there was a, what kind of man? A lame man. How long had he been lame? All of his life. He was born lame from his mother's womb. And how many times did people pass him by? No doubt Peter and John had passed him before. But something was different that day. They had passed him before. No doubt maybe they had reached in their pocket in other times and pulled out a few coins and say, there you go, but dear buddy. I feel bad. That's just what all can do. And made their way on. But today was not like any other day. Let me tell you, tomorrow morning, tonight doesn't need to be like any other day. There can, if you got the anointing of God, if you have received the Holy Ghost, you've received the power. And if you receive the power, you've received the witness. And if you receive the witness, you have something to give. And there was something I found this day that I had never seen before. And the Bible tells us, but that day was totally different like any other day. Something had changed in their life. They were now not walking according to their ability. They were walking in the power of the Holy Ghost, the promise that was given to them, and the same promise that's given to you and I. And we are told that this man is sitting there. And notice the Bible says, he knew something was coming his way. He looked on them and he was respecting to receive something from them. And he looked upon them with that anticipation, thinking that he's going to receive. Maybe I'll get a little bit to help me this week and pay the bills and get through that and all that. And he looked and he looked upon him and he saw something. Notice what happened here. And here's what haunts me. If you could take a video and show that video and then slow that thing way down and just, you know, it's just, what do you call those things? Clip by clip. It's just a little thing going there. And if you could have seen it all, within themselves, they had nothing to give. They didn't have anything. But they had that power. And they said, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have give I thee. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And this is what I never saw before till this afternoon. Verse 6 of chapter 3. And he, speaking of Peter, took him by the right hand and lifted him up. It wasn't the lame man that moved first. If it hadn't been for Peter stepping into action, he would still be laying there if he could live this long. But wasn't the lame man's faith that reached out? It was the man that had the power of a witness in him that said, silver and gold have I none, pal, but such as I have give I thee in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Rise up and walk. And I always assumed that he just jumped up himself. I understand that Peter reached out. He may have said, hey, can you help me up then? Can you help? I can't stand up very good. Can you help me out? It didn't happen that way. Peter reached down. Only thing he had done was spoken a word of faith. Man, I hope I can get this through your head. All he did was speak a word of faith, and then he stepped into action. He spoke it, and then he said, I got to do one more thing in that. He reaches down with his hand, and he just pulls him up. Why? Because it was his faith. Listen to me. Listen, Saginaw Valley, if we think people are just going to come through those doors and come down to this altar and repent of their sins and God's going to force feed them by getting the Holy Ghost, we're wrong. We need to have an understanding that God has put some power within us and he's given us the ability. I just wonder if Peter, when he was saying those words, silver and gold have I none, he's made, what an idiot am I saying? But realize he's being a witness. Silver and gold have I none, but such I have, give I thee in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And he reaches down and he pulls. Here's what haunts me. How many people have I proclaimed, but I never reached for? How many people have I ever said, God's going to help you and God's going to deliver you, but I turn around and I walk away? How many... Kyle, how many, Zach, how many guys on Wednesday night, kids come in here on Wednesday night and we teach the word of God, but we don't do any farther than that. Somehow, Saginaw Valley, we got to realize, and I know I'm going a little long here, but that's all right, I'm pastor. I'm just here to tell you, somehow we got to realize we got to do more than proclaim it. Somehow we got to reach down and say, come on, you're coming out of that mess. I'm going to bring you out with the power of the Lord upon my life. I'm going to, what I have, give ID. I got faith enough to your situation. I know you don't think you can, but I know you can. I know you don't think you can, but I want to tell you the power that's in me is going to be in you, and I'm going to pull you up out of this dilemma. Come on, Saginaw. They don't want to come out. Yeah, they do want to come out, but they're crippled. They can't come out. It's going to take a church reaching out and picking them up and pulling them out. That's the Holy Ghost that you have in you, pal. Now you can sit on it all you want. And those lame men can be lame when you come in, and they can be lame when you can go out. But I'm here to tell you, when somebody had the gift of faith to proclaim something, to step into action, bones started snapping. Things started happening. Those legs that never knew strength got strength. Have you ever seen legs that never have strength? They're little puny things. They don't have no ability. They have no muscle in them. But because of a man's faith reaching down and pulling him up, something supernatural began to happen. There was a popping. There was a change that began to happen. I'm here to tell you, I believe God in this city wants to do a popping. And I believe he wants to do something that is beyond our imagination. But it's the fact that you as a believer and I as a believer got to believe that our God is well able to do exceedingly and abundantly and above all that I can ask or even think. And just, I love the progression here. He stands up on his own 2 feet first. Then the Bible says he leaped. Then the Bible says that as he's standing on his feet, the next step is he began a journey. Don't start shooting people. Don't start criticizing people because they can't run like you run yet. Would you first let them walk? Would you first let them walk? Would you let them bring them out? Then don't put gospel down their throat until they choke them. Why don't you just let them get up? Why don't you let some strength come to those legs? They're going to be amazed at just how God brought them out of sin. But I'm here to tell you, he wants to do much more than that. That same power within you needs to be with him. But first, they're going to have to learn to walk. Then they're going to have to leap. Then they're going to have to learn how to praise God. I'm here to tell you, there's a progression here that we need to realize that we as a church, we are responsible for. Kyle and Janessa are going to have a baby. Now, I'm here to tell you, I heard that Grandpa has a picture of that baby next to his bed already. That's some crazy Grandpa stuff right there. It's an ultrasound. And he has a picture next to his bed of a child that's unborn. But listen, it would be terrible if that little, what's her name? Mariala? Oh, what is it, a boy or girl? I don't know. It's a girl. Okay, thank you. I just names don't mean nothing anymore to me. Sometimes I find out, but it would be terrible if you guys have that child and then you just leave her in the crib. You never get her up. It'd be terrible if you never tried to help her walk. It would be terrible when she fell down. You said, "What a stupid kid! You really didn't love. You really don't want to live. You don't want to learn to walk. You're just a little loser. Listen, the power of God that's in you needs to flow into them. I don't have time to finish this, but the Bible, this is, and I'm done, listen, just before I get to the hula hoops. The Bible says when all the people saw him walking and praising God, they came from everywhere because they knew that it was the lame man that had sat at that gate for so long. And the Bible says that it happened on the porch. Now listen to this. And when that happened, the Bible says it became noised abroad, and that porch became crowded with people there to see the miracle. Now I'm gonna just be right honest with you there. That's when ministry really should have started taking place. That's when you can say, man, I want to be a part of that 1,000 soul revival. I want to be there when there's so many people packing it. They're looking in those side windows. They're in that nursery. They're in there, and I want to be so used by God. Then listen, you'll never have that experience until you're willing to reach the lame man. Because God doesn't take you from just having received power to put you in the arena of thousands. Because you know what? It will so mess with your head. You'll start thinking it's you and not God. It's your ability. Look what I've done. But those boys that day understood before they could ever get to the thousands, they had to first deal with a lame man. A lame man that was lame from his mother's womb. I'm here to tell the Saginaw Valley, I believe God wants to give us thousands upon thousands of souls. Anyone in this place believe that? Anyone in this place believe that this place could be packed? You know what I'm dreaming of? I'm dreaming of that wall right there, knocking that wall out right there and putting seats back there. I'm looking at knocking that wall out and putting seats back there. I'm looking for the day that we have to have Saturday night service at 6:00. Because everyone that comes on Sunday morning can't fit in here. And so they have to have a Saturday night. And then you have to have a Sunday morning. And then we're going to have to really mess with some of you. Because we're going to have to bump you to an 8:00 service. Because we need to have an 11:00 service. Listen, I know churches that aren't spirit-filled to have that. I'm not here to knock that. I'm just here to tell you they don't have the power that you have. Because they don't have the anointing that you have, because they don't speak in tongues. You may say I'm pretty nasty there. I'm just telling you that's where the word of God says. You don't get that power any other way. And I'm just believing God can do that. But listen, it's not going to come by tens of thousands. It's going to become by that lame man that you pass every day. That man that you've walked by every day. And you may have tried, you may have felt sorry for him. But I'm here to tell you, if God has put his spirit within you, if his power is resident within you, I'm here to tell you, you got the ability to be a witness. And if you have the ability to be the witness, you have the ability to have the power. And if you have the power, friend, I'm here to tell you, there's nothing that you and God can't do. I mean, I don't know if you people believe that or not. I'm just telling you, there's nothing you can't do. My hula hoop. Why I ask you to bring a hula hoop tonight, it goes back to Gypsy Smith. Gypsy Smith said there's two things you got to do. You got to go to that highest point in the city. Just something that he said. And you got to pray over that city. I'm asking you if you'll do something with me. Every time you cross the Milwaukee Bridge, would you speak to that city? Would you speak to that city and claim it for the name of the Lord? When you cross down in town and you drive through town, would you say, God, this city's going to hear your voice. They're going to respond to you, oh God, and you're going to do great exploits in this house, in this city. I believe God can, and I believe he will. Can anyone else believe with me? Amen. But Gypsy says, there's one more thing I got to tell you. I do. After I've prayed that God would send revival to that city, he says, I go and get me a piece of chalk and I draw me a circle. And I say, God, if revival is going to come to this city, circle. And I lift my head to heaven and say, God, the revival that needs to come needs to start right here. I'm not asking for anything else out there. I'm not asking for the lame man, and I'm not asking for the tens of thousands on the porch, Solomon's porch, because I can't get there if I don't have revival here first. I've asked you to bring a hula hoop. I went and bought some. I see some other folks got them. I would love to close this service out tonight with us getting in some hula hoops. Saying, God, if you're going to bring revival to my life, if you're going to bring revival to my teaching on Wednesday night and my teaching on Sunday and my ability to sing on a Sunday and to be a part of the praise group, if Lord, if you're going to bless me to be an usher, if you're going to bless me to be a greeter, if you're going to bless me to do anything in the work of God to be a witness, God, I first got to have you help me right here. Because if you can't help me here, you can't help me here. If you don't first do the work with me in that circle, and then nothing else is going to happen. I'm just here to tell the Saginaw Valley something needs to get a hold of us. Something needs to so grip us. Before we'll beat anyone else up, why don't we ask God to beat us up? Why don't we ask God to expose any area of my life that I need to throw some things away? I need to have some spring house cleaning in my life. God, I want to be that individual. I want to put on the whole armor of God. I want to have everything that you have for me, Lord, but I can't get it when I'm outside the circle. So before you can touch anything else, would you touch me? Would you do a work in my life? Would you forgive me of my sin? Would you cleanse me, oh God? Would you make me straight? Because, Lord, when I step out of that circle, I'm coming out with a power. I'm coming out with authority. I'm coming out with might. It's not by might. It's not my power, but it's by his spirit, saith God. Come on, Saginaw. Somehow we got to get in that circle. Somehow we got to call upon the name of the Lord. God, before you bless this city, before you touch this city, before you bring revival, would you bring revival to my little hula hoop right here, oh God? Come on, would you stand with me right now? Come on, would you stand with me right now? Listen, maybe you didn't bring a hula hoop. Maybe there's not enough hula hoops to go around. But if I could have done it, I'd have bring you. He used chalk. That's what he used. I don't want you putting chalk carpet, or I'd have put, I'm just here to tell us, folks, listen, somehow we got to get this thing down right. Somehow we got to get it. If we're ever going to be the church that we need to be, it has to start right here. It has to start with pastor. It has to start with pastor saying, God, listen, I'm asking you to move in this church like never before. Would you bring revival to this city like never before? Would you bring revival to Saginaw Valley like never before? But, oh God, I'm stepping in this hula hoop tonight, and I'm going to ask you, would you start the revival right here? I just wonder if anyone would join me with a hula hoop. Maybe you'll pray a prayer and then you step out and you let someone else take over. I know it's not the hula hoop. I'm not that ignorant. It's just a representative of where we're talking about. God, I need you to move in my life right here. I don't know about my brother. I don't know about my sister, but it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. It's not my brother. It's not my sister, but it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. God, I need revival in my life like never before, because when I have revival, I got the anointing. I got the power. I got the witness. I have everything I'm ever going to need if I get it. Now, come on. Would you just step out? Would you come join me here tonight? And would you throw a hula hoop down? Would you Maybe just put a circle on the floor. Someone can come get this one right here. My little buggy can't get in it, but what would happen if Saginaw Valley, what would happen is if we as a church would so be moved that when we walk out of this house on a Sunday night, we're walking out in power and demonstrations of the Holy Ghost. Wouldn't it be an incredible thing on a Sunday morning? Listen, I heard a man prophesy this one day when I was a little boy. Listen to me. This is what he said. He said, I'm believing there's coming a day that it's on a Sunday morning. We don't have time to have an altar call, so much to say, but there's going to be a line up of people waiting to get baptized because the body of Christ has been teaching Bible studies all week long. They've been praying for people in the jobs and on the marketplace and next door neighbors across the fence. And they're praying. Listen to me. He said this. You're praying people through to the Holy Ghost. That on Sunday morning, the only thing that you can do on Sunday morning is just baptize those that need to be baptized. Why? Because there's such a revival. Let me tell you, I believe God can do that. And if you don't tell me he can't, because I want to believe he can. I want to believe the power that New Testament church has, Saginaw Valley has. The anointing that New Testament church has, Saginaw Valley has. I want there to be a holy boldness about this church. Man, you better watch out. If you see me at Walmart and I'm in need, I have somebody coming my way to pray a prayer of faith for me that will say, I'm not only going to pray for you, I'm going to bring you out of that situation. I may have to spend time with you. I may have to spend nights with you. I may have to take you out to eat. I may have to put groceries on your table. I may have, you got to do whatever you got to do. What you're doing, you're pulling them out. Those crippled legs don't have the strength within themselves, but the power of the Holy Ghost does. Come on, would you begin to pray right now? In that little hula hoop. In that little hula hoop. There's some more hula hoops around here if you need a hula hoop. But come on. I need somebody that will begin to cry out to God. I need somebody that needs to say, God, it's going to start right here. If it's going to be in my family, it's going to start right here. If it's going to be in this church, Lord, it's going to start right here. If it's going to be in my Sunday school classroom, it's going to start right here. If it's going to be in my Wednesday night, it's going to start right here. If it's going to start in my music ministry, it's going to start right here. Oh, God, bring revival. Bring revival to my hula hoop, oh, God. Oh, bring revival to my home. Bring revival to my home, oh God. But Lord, first would you start with me right here, right now, in this place. Come on. Come on, I need people that know how to cry out to God right now. Come on, I need people that know how to cry out to God. Listen, he wants to empower you. Listen, he wants to empower you, not for this kingdom, not for the kingdom of this world, but for the kingdom of God. Come on. Oh, God. Lord, would you put a hula hoop around this whole church right now? Lord, would you put a hula hoop around this, oh God? Would you send revival to this hula hoop? Oh, God, forgive me. God, allow there to be a cleansing. Allow there to be a renewing of your spirit. Lord, I haven't seen the tap into that power. But oh God, before I leave this hula hoop, I'm believing that you're going to do a great work. In the name of Jesus, come on. Come on. Oh, in the name of Jesus. Ikorobo shatabahaya nikirororobohoya. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. That's it. Cry out to him. That's it. Cry out to him. Oh God. Lord, I don't want another kid to walk past me in the hallway. I don't want another young person to walk into the sanctuary. Lord, I don't want no mom and dad to walk in this place on a Sunday morning. Lord, without the power of the Holy Ghost flowing out of me,
every chain is loose. God, we declare your kingdom is here. Everyone will see, fall down at your feet. God, we declare your kingdom is here.
Mountains have to move, and every chain is loose. God, we declare your kingdom is here. Everyone will see, fall down at your feet. God, we declare your kingdom is here. Mountains have to move, and every chain is loose. For God, we declare your kingdom is here. Everyone will see, fall down at your feet. God, we declare your kingdom is here. Everything changes, everything changes when your kingdom comes.
Come on, Saginaw. Come on, Saginaw Valley. Let the revival start in our hula hoops. You may want to step over in the hula hoop of your spouse right now and pray there. Maybe a teacher with another teacher wants to step into a hula hoop, and maybe other ministries just working together, but in the last part of this service, maybe we need to join someone else in our hula hoop. I'm asking you if you can take them home, the ones that we brought, you can have. I need a hula hoop because I'm going to put a hula hoop in my office. When I look at it, I want to say, God, are you moving? Revival happening in my life. If revival is going to be there, there's going to be changes there. Whenever a church has a great revival, you can go back sometime later and it's like, it's not the same church. What happened? There was a revival there. What would happen if we would all recognize that we've had such a revival in our hearts and our lives that some things have changed? We put off the things of darkness. We've stepped into what Romans chapter 13 tells us, that we've wakened out of sleep. Salvation is right around the corner. Understanding the night is far spent and the day is at hand. God, help me to strip myself of everything else of this world. Because we as the children of God belong to the day and not of the night. It's not our job to get tangled with the things of this world. But our job is to put on the Lord Jesus Christ, making no provision to the flesh, to the fulfillment thereof. God, would you baptize this church with that kind of revival? God, would you baptize this church's leadership with that kind of revival? Would you start with me, God? For every household in this place, would you do a fresh work? Oh, God, every man in this house. Lord, this is the Sunday night crowd is the crowd that gets it done. The Sunday night crowd is a crowd that you can depend upon. God, but we just need more than just dependability. We need anointing. We need power. God, we need the faith to believe that if you did it for Paul and John, Peter and John, you can do it in Kevin and Sandy's life. Lord, you can do it in our life because we've stood in that circle and revival came to our circle long before it ever came to this church. Oh God, allow there to be a change. I admit to this church, pastor needs to do some change and I need revival to flow into my hula hoop again. Come on. Come on, Saginaw Valley, let's join into this circle. We're not leaving the circle. We're going to minister from the circle. We're not stepping out any longer, but the revival soul is going to flow in our hearts and our lives, and I'm going to reach people outside of it in the name of Jesus. Come on, in this solemn touch of God that's in this place right now. Come on, I believe the Lord's speaking. Maybe God's revealing some things right now, some things that need to be removed. Maybe it's some attitudes. Maybe it's unforgiveness. Maybe it's a grudge. God, we got to have unity. If you're going to do what you did in that New Testament church, we got to have unity like never before. Oh, Holy Ghost. Oh, Holy Ghost. Would it be too tough if we begin to intercede for that lame man? Could we begin to intercede for our classrooms and those that gather in here on Sunday morning? Could somebody just step into an atmosphere of intercession right now? Sometimes that intercession will lead you to groanings that you have no idea what you're saying. But in the Holy Ghost, there's a divine work happening. Oh, Jesus. Come on. Come on, I believe God wants to do something right here, right now. In this peaceful moment right here. a solid moment of God's presence. I pray for this city, oh God. I pray for this city. They don't know you, God. They're so far from knowing you. My neighborhood, oh God, my neighbors, they don't know you. Lord, they've been lame from their mother's womb. They don't have the ability, even if they could, they couldn't walk. Yes. I thank you for your sweet presence I feel in this house. Lord, you always amaze me that when we humble ourselves before you, you always show up. When we confess our faults, you're faithful and just to forgive us. You amaze me, oh God. You amaze me, God, when your people, which are called by your name, will humble themselves and pray and seek your face. You amaze me that you will heal our land and you'll do a divine work. You just amaze me. Lord, I'm amazed as I feel your presence right now. I believe the transformation that's coming to some of us in this room. We're going to strip ourselves of some things. We're going to be closed with you, oh God, your presence. Lord, we're going to be praying for revival, but first let it start in me. Thank you for your presence. Your presence is going to go with us now. We're going to go home, lay down, get rest for our bodies. But tomorrow when we rise, we're rising as those that have power and authority in your name. Give us that holy boldness, O God, to proclaim the words of God. Give us that boldness to proclaim our testimony. Then I pray, God, that you would help us to have the faith to believe that, God, that lame man, that lame woman can come out of that situation. You're going to give us the wisdom and the knowledge and how to deal with it. Lord, I believe that someday there's individuals in this house, because we have learned to deal with the ones and the twos, that one day we will minister to the thousands because of the great might that you have placed within us. We give you the glory and we give you the honor, give you the praise in the wonderful name of Jesus. God bless you, Saginaw Valley. Thank you for being here. Thanking you for allowing me to speak as long as I did. Take your hula hoop home. Let God bring revival to your circle. In the name of the Lord Jesus, we pray. Amen.